2 days there. And we have been working on the idea of sensory strength and right effort on the normal lateral path, that part of the gradual training here. And obviously the main problem of the defilements is anger and ill will, as I've been saying a few times already here. But now that we have covered that, I also want to have a little bit of a look at sense desire and sense pleasures and this side of things as well, because that also is a fact thing that often comes up in meditation practice and can be problematic on the path. And of course, the idea in Buddhism is eventually to overcome these things, is that you go to a deeper kind of happiness which is beyond these things. So to be able to do that, it's important to think about these things in the right way, to reflect about them in a way which is constructive for the path. And as you do that, actually these things tend to start to fade away, become less important. It's an interesting combination of reflecting in the right way and then deepening your meditation to see the alternatives. Yeah, what is the alternative to sensual pleasures? And as you do that, these two things together kind of, you know, make the path work very, very well as a consequence. So always kind of reflecting, and then the direct experience through meditation is very, very useful. So the sutta I'm going to have a look at is called the Tvottalaya Sutta. It's the next one in the list here. And it is from the mid-length sayings of the Buddha, Majjhima Nikaya 54. And this is a series of 7 similes to describe sense pleasures. And some of these similes are really powerful, they're really kind of strong, and they sort of stand out. So what I'm going to do is to try to draw out the meaning of these similes. And these are the suttas I read out of every retreat. I do quite a few retreats a year, maybe 6 or 7 retreats a year. So I get to read this same sutta 6 or 7 times, retreat every year. I'm so lucky, right? So this same kind of wonderful sutta. You may think perhaps it gets boring after a while then. But it's of course occasionally, you're not as inspired as other times. But actually, I never really get bored with these things because they actually are very inspiring. Every time you read them, they kind of sink in, maybe one little notch deeper, and you know what's going on with these things. So for that reason, I'm not really so concerned about that. Anyway, so this is the Tvottalaya Sutta. It's the Buddha talking to a householder called Tvottalaya. This householder is claiming to be one who has given up all affairs in the worldly life. The Buddha points out, well, actually, maybe you haven't. Maybe there's a few things you're holding on to. And this householder is not too pleased with that. And then the Buddha gives him these 7 similes, talking about sense pleasures and where kind of the problems lie, etc. Now, when we talk about the word sense pleasures in Buddhism, it's important to get an idea what this really refers to. The Pali word is karma. There's 2 words in Pali. One is karma, the other one is kamma. Can you hear the difference? Karma, kamma. One has a long A in it, the other one has a double M. So in Pali you pronounce double consonants. In English you don't pronounce double consonants really, so you can't hear it, but kamma, twice, kamma. There's a difference there. So karma is different from kamma. Kamma means action. Kamma means like sensuality or sense pleasures. And this word has like a double meaning in the sutta. It's important to understand that double meaning, to really understand how these symbols work. And on the one hand, karma refers to all the objects of the sensual, of the senses in the world. All the things that we attach to in the world. All the things that we enjoy, entertainments, the things we store up, people we are attached to, all of these things, the objects of the 5 senses is karma. That's the one side of it. The other side of it is the desire, if you like, the subjective experience of desire for those particular objects. That's also called karma. And only when you understand these 2 sides of the this word, do these similes make full sense, and they actually come out very nicely as a consequence. So, subjective desire, but also the objects of desire, also called karma. So, keeping that in mind, let's start with the first one of these similes and see what this, how we can make sense of this. So, householder, suppose a dog overcome by hunger and weakness was waiting by a butcher's shop. Then a skilled butcher or his apprentice would toss the dog a well-hacked, clean-hacked skeleton of meatless bones smeared with blood. What do you think, householder? Would that dog get rid of its hunger and weakness by gnawing such a well-hacked, clean-hacked skeleton of meatless bones smeared with blood? No, venerable sir. Why is that? Because that was a skeleton of well-hacked, clean-hacked, meatless bones smeared with blood. Eventually that dog would reap weariness and disappointment. So too, householder, a noble disciple considers thus. Sensual pleasures have been compared to a skeleton by the Blessed One. They provide much suffering and much despair, while the danger in them is great. So why are sensual pleasures like a skeleton? What is going on here? What is the significance of this particular simile here? And the point here is that this dog, this poor dog is running around trying to find some kind of nourishment. I don't know if you have seen the dogs of India. They're pretty miserable creatures. In the Western world, dogs are pampered. Well, at least if they live in a good family, they're looked after, well groomed, washed every now and again. They get some nice food. In India, they look terrible. They look like they're kind of really scrawny and really all the fur is falling off, and they look terrible usually. And you don't even have compassion for them because they're so kind of aggressive at the same time. So it's kind of very unfortunate to be a dog in some of these countries. Anyway, so if you are like that kind of dog, you don't have an owner, nobody to look after you, you have to look after yourself. You run around, and of course the butcher is often a good place to go if you're a dog. So you go to the butcher shop, the butcher is not going to waste any meat on you. The butcher hacks those bones as clean as absolutely possible. There's not a gram of meat left because that kind of has a value to it. But there's a bit of blood. You can't get all the blood off the bones, so there's a bit of blood left. And when the butcher is happy with the bone, got all the meat off, and he looks at the dog, you chuck your bone, you miserable creature. And he chucks the bone to the dog. What does the dog do? The dog is so happy. And it starts gnawing this bone, and it gets the taste of blood. It gets a little bit of taste, but there's no sustenance there. There's nothing to keep it going. There's nothing to kind of make it satisfied, to feel a sense of, it has actually achieved anything. So you get all that happens because you get the taste of what is going on. You get more craving without being really satisfied. And then you run off to the next butcher. And what does the next butcher do? The next butcher is just as mean as the previous one. At least in the simile, in reality they might not be, but in the simile they are. Runs off to the next butcher, does exactly the same thing. And so the dog goes on and on, from butcher to butcher. And it keeps on going like that, and the dog dies. It's reborn as a dog in the next life, because they're attached to being a dog. And it continues on, running from butcher to butcher in the next life. And so it goes on and on and on, and there is no end in sight of that. And this is exactly what sensual pleasures are like. You run out of things, and then you get your object, the thing that you think is going to satisfy you. It doesn't satisfy you for long. In fact, often it doesn't really satisfy you at all. Part of the satisfaction, there's still craving there. And then when you know it doesn't really satisfy you, you go on to the next object. You're like this dog running from one butcher to the next one. On and on and on. And as you do that, in the middle of all the running, still trying to fulfill your goals that can never be met by the very nature, you die, and then you get reborn, and you can hit the ground running in your next life, craving more, running on to the next one, and you keep on doing that again and again and again. And there's no goal in this thing. That's the kind of a scary thing. But if you ask yourself, if you sit down and you feel the craving, what does the craving whisper in your ear? What does the craving say to you? Craving says, if you get this, you will be satisfied. This is what craving always says, right? If you get this, you will be happy, you will be content, you will be satisfied, you will feel a sense of completion, you will have reached a certain goal, the purpose, the aim, you will have reached an aim. But actually you haven't. And beyond that craving, there's always more craving. There's always more running on and on and on. There is no real goal. It's this roaming around in samsaric existence without never going anywhere, and all the while craving is lying in your ear telling you that you will find some kind of satisfaction. And we never get it. We never understand that there's a problem until the Buddha arises. Well, maybe it doesn't have to be Buddha to understand these things, because this is not quite that profound, but someone of certain spiritual insights actually gets this and tells you, wait a minute, what are you doing? It doesn't make any sense. Well, actually you have a point. What are we doing? What are we running after? And then you kind of get it, but often we need to be told these things from someone outside of us, because we are so blinded by this ever, forever running on. And once you get this, it's kind of scary, isn't it? That there is actually not going anywhere. You're just keeping on doing the same stupid thing, on and on and on, without end in sight. But then the Buddha says there is an alternative. It doesn't have to be like this. What is the alternative? The alternative is to search for that satisfaction that craving promises you, instead of going with a lie every time and thinking that craving is going to satisfy it, search somewhere else. And you actually find the very thing that craving was promising you, you find it in a different way. This is the interesting thing. Craving is lying in the sense that you are looking in the wrong place, but actually that satisfaction can be found. Because we're looking in the wrong place. Where are we supposed to look? And of course, the place you're supposed to look is for those happinesses that are found on the spiritual path. Why is that? Well, the reason is because when you do an act of kindness, an act of generosity or something, that is a very different kind of happiness than the happiness you achieve through searching for sensual objects or sensuality. The happiness that you get through doing an act of kindness, you're kind to someone, you feel good about yourself right here in the present moment. There's no craving that goes with that. If there is craving, it's about something else. But that craving is not craving, that happiness is a happiness in the present moment. And that is why it is so useful for meditation practice. That is why when we live well, we do the right things, and we give rise to happiness that belongs to the present moment. And that's why meditation becomes possible, because that happiness draws the mind into the present moment. Mindfulness arises. As a consequence, you're able to follow the breath, you're able to follow any meditation object. And then what happens is that you keep on building up that present moment happiness. You are purify yourself more and more. You are generous in a kind of higher and higher way, if you like. Then you start to do your meditation practice. And you start to find fulfillment in that meditation practice. You become more and more content. You start to feel experiences of happiness that you never had before in your entire life, maybe many lifetimes. And those happinesses become so intense, so satisfactory, so give you such a sense of completion, that there comes a point where you feel nothing anymore moves you. All craving is absolutely vanished because the present moment is so beautiful, it is so powerful, there's nothing more to be done in life. You have found complete contentment through finding happiness in the present moment. At that point, when there is no more itch, there's nothing more to drive you forward, there's nothing more to do, you feel like, I could sit here forever because I don't have anything more to do. What is that? Well, that is having found the meaning of life. If there's nothing more to be done, you have found the meaning, right? By definition, if there's nothing to do, you have found the goal, you have found the purpose, you have found the aim. By definition. And this you find through the spiritual path, through your meditation practice, through all of these other things that are part of this remarkable path of Buddhism. So that is the distinction between the and why the worldly happiness is so problematic, and why the spiritual happiness is in the end fill in that hole that we have inside of us, the hole that is craving, the itch inside, which always drives you forward. Suddenly it's gone. Everything is filled in. You feel complete. You feel satisfied. You have reached a real goal, a real purpose, a real aim in life. That is the difference. And of course, it doesn't end with samadhi. Samadhi gives you this first glimpse of complete satisfaction of the path. But it doesn't quite end there, because the samadhi itself cannot be sustained. But because it can't be sustained, then the next thing to do is to also gain the insight. When you gain that insight, that is where you actually make this completion, satisfaction, you make it permanent. You make it something which is always, always there, always present in your life. That is where you reach the final fulfillment of the path, the final goal, complete satisfaction. Nothing more to be done. Does it sound scary not to have anything more to be done? It sounds kind of weird sometimes, yeah? Nothing more to do. All you can do is sit on your bottom, and be perfectly happy. It's kind of some of those images you see of some of these people who are considered like saints. And there was one very famous Indian saint. He wasn't a Buddhist, he was a Hindu, but he always had incredibly good meditation practice. His name was Ramana Maharshi, he lived back in the 1950s. And if you look up on the internet, there's still some ancient grainy footage of him available on the internet. But he obviously had samadhi, and it shows you what samadhi can do for you, yeah, how satisfied you are. This was a very kind of... So what he was doing, he had this little concrete hut, yeah? Very, very simple, those concrete walls, maybe 5 square meters inside. And he had a kind of light bulb dangling from the ceiling, and a kind of classical, very, very simple thing, which, you know, ultra simple there. And then he had a loincloth, yeah, that's all he had. And he sat on this concrete porch, yeah, and he sat there all the time in his light, in his loincloth, and this light bulb dangling down. And when it got dark, he would turn on the light bulb. When it got lighting, he'd turn it off. But that was kind of his life, and that's all he did. It looks so simple, but it shows you the kind of, you know, once you have reached the purpose in life, the goal in life, there's nothing more to be done. Well, that's what you do. You sit there on your little concrete porch, there's nothing to be done, and you're perfectly happy with that. Nothing, nowhere else to go. And for most people, it looks really weird. Why are you sitting there? Why not doing something? Why don't you build yourself a larger house? Yeah, that light bulb is a bit too simple. But it's not having a kind of lampshade around that light bulb. Yeah, it looks a bit bare the way it is now. But he's not interested in that. It's completely irrelevant. And it's a nice picture of this idea of being satisfied, feeling complete, nothing more to be done. So remember that, every time you crave, watch the feeling of craving. Look at what is going on, and compare that to the satisfaction you have when you are really content and really happy in your meditation practice. There's a vast difference there. There's a kind of a gulf between the two. And try to see if you can. Okay. Next simile. Householder, suppose a vulture, a heron, or a hawk seized a piece of meat and flew away, and then other vultures, herons, or hawks pursued it, pecked and clawed it. What do you think, householder, if that vulture, heron, or hawk does not quickly let go of that piece of meat? Wouldn't it incur death or death-like suffering because of that? Yes, venerable sir. So too, householder, a noble disciple considers thus. 7 short pleasures have been compared to a piece of meat by the Blessed One. They provide much suffering and much despair, while the danger in them is great. So here you have this idea of, you know, finally a bird gets hold of a piece of meat. This is very difficult for birds to get hold of. So you're very happy, yeah, you are a little bird flying away a piece of meat, so happy. And as soon as you get hold of that piece of meat, other birds, they also want that meat, because it's rare and difficult for birds to get hold of, so they pursue you. Yeah, you're one little bird, and this whole flock comes after you, and they try to rip that piece of meat out of your claws. Yeah, and then eventually, if you don't let go of that one, well, you probably will die. If you don't die, you get death-like suffering. Not really deadly suffering, death-like suffering is much more an appropriate translation. So, what is this all about? Of course, what this is about is that the sensual pleasures of the world, we tend to fight over those. Yeah? Especially the sensual objects of the world, we're never really satisfied, and because we're not satisfied, we fight with other people. It is very obvious in the area of finding a partner in life, a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a husband or wife or whatever else it might be. That is kind of the obvious area we fight. We kind of desire the same people, because we desire the same people. We do bad things to get our rivals out of the way, yeah? We fight over things. And there's so many areas in life where we fight over things. Somebody was talking about company or a workplace politics, how people fight kind of get the attention of the manager to get the next pay rise or to move up the kind of the ladder of the hierarchy at work and all these kind of things. Yeah? And you fight and you backstab each other and you have office politics and all these kind of things. People tell me about office politics all the time. Is it true? Is it the thing as office politics? Yeah, people say, is it, have you got it here as well then? Got it everywhere probably, yeah, it's probably kind of a universal thing, yeah. So, and it sounds terrible. You want to go to work, you just want to do your job, and you want to kind of make a decent living for yourself, and you have to have all these troubles and problems because of that. So that is an important part of life. And of course, in so many areas of life, we kind of we have this problem of being of fighting with each other, or being kind of at odds with each other, and because of because we, there isn't, the cake is never really large enough. Yeah, the cake has to be, the economic cake is only so large. And if I have one piece and you want more of yours, sometimes I have to give up a little bit of my piece to give to you because you want more. And that's where fights, violence, and all of these things come out as a consequence. When people die and you don't want the inheritance, what happens? People fight over the inheritance. And the larger the inheritance is, the more they fight. Crazy, isn't it? You'd think that if the inheritance was really large, they wouldn't fight, but actually it's the exact opposite. The larger it is, the more they fight. The really wealthy people, they go to court and they kind of do all kind of mad things. It's completely nuts. And but you see it from the very beginning. Children, as they grow up, they fight over the last cookie or the toy they want to play with or whatever. And life is full of this rivalry, trying to win. And this is one of those, I think, very important insights of the Buddha, is the idea that sensuality always leads to rivalry, always leads to conflict, always often leads to violence. Yeah, so many of the wars that are done in the world, what are the wars about? They're wars about, I think, to a large part, about resources. Yeah, and what about all these Gulf Wars, where obviously the oil had some play probably, and in, you know, people coming to war. What are resources about? Resources are about looking after your own economy, making sure your economy is good, so that your people are happy. Yeah, forget about those other people, they don't matter. My country is what matters. So much in the world is, I think, comes down to sensual pleasures. And so much of the violence in the world comes from sensual pleasures, ultimately. Yeah? Isn't that kind of off-putting? What do you think about it that way? Yeah? Isn't this really problematic? Yeah? And the alternative, of course, isn't to, instead of having sensual pleasures, instead of that, you find the happiness within that. And the happiness that you have within, through being kind, or through being generous, or through being, you know, having success in a meditation practice, is a very different kind. It is a kind of happiness which has no conflict to it. It is an internal thing. In fact, it enables you to live a life without conflict, because you are satisfied within yourself, not seeking for anything outside. Because you have that sense of satisfaction already, it leads to non-conflict specifically. So you search for the happiness within. It's a happiness that is yours alone, that nobody can really take that from you anyway. It cannot be any rivalry about the inner happiness. It belongs to each one of us. And ultimately, it also leads to harmony in society. It leads to a world with less conflict, less violence, less strife. This is one of the reasons why the path, the meditation, is so beautiful in many ways, because it adds so many layers of additional benefit apart from the fact that it's good for ourselves, it's good for society, it's good in so many different ways. So this is this other thing, so remember that, yeah, sexuality, in the end, it leads to conflict, it leads to problems. It is almost impossible to live a life of sensual pleasures fully without also, without having any kind of conflict at the same time. There's a nice sutta about this. The sutta is called the Sakkapanya Sutta in the Digha Nikaya. I think it is Digha Nikaya number 21. I think it's 21, something like that. And in that sutta, the Sakka is the kind of god of the heaven of the 33. He comes down to the Buddha and he asks the Buddha, why is it that people, even though they want to live in harmony, they want to live in happiness and all of these things, despite that, there is so much strife and trouble in the world, there's so much violence, there's so much enmity going on. Why is it? We want to live well, we want to live in harmony, but we can't seem to do it. What's the reason? And the Buddha analyzes that and brings it back to depart, back to desire. He had a desire for things, and then the strife and the problems that arise from that. So this is like a root cause. So the idea that we should be able to live happily in the world while enjoying sensual pleasures is actually an illusion. The only way you're going to be able to go beyond that, beyond violence, is to actually go beyond sensuality itself. This is kind of radical, isn't it? So it is really only a personal thing that we can do personally. We can't compel the rest of society to go beyond sensuality. So it becomes very much a personal pursuit in this sense. Okay. Next one. Householder, suppose a man took a blazing brass torch and went against the wind. What do you think, householder? If that man does not quickly let go of that blazing grass torch, wouldn't that blazing grass torch burn his hand or his arm or some other part of his body, so that he might incur death or death-like suffering because of that? Yes, venerable sir, so too, householder, a noble disciple considers thus. Sensual pleasures have been compared to a grass torch by the Blessed One. They provide much suffering and much despair, while the danger in them is great. So a grass torch, yeah, is a torch of straw, and you light it in one end, and of course, because it's a torch of straw, you hold it up, and the wind comes the other direction, the embers come off all the time, because the embers come off, and they hit you, and you've got some kind of, you know, cloth or whatever, which easily burns, you get burned as a consequence of all the embers coming back on you. So the grass torch, it has its use. It gives you a little bit of satisfaction because you can see what you're doing. You don't step over that precipice or whatever it is, yeah, which is obviously very useful. But it also has great limits, especially if you walk against the wind, as it says here. So what has this got to do with sensual pleasures? Of course, the idea of picking up the grass torch is the same idea as picking up the sensual objects in the world, right? The Pali word upadana, you may, if you know your sequence of dependent origination in Pali, you have vedana, tanha, upadana. Vedana is feeling, from feeling comes craving, tanha, from tanha comes upadana. And upadana is sometimes translated as clinging. This is Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi's favorite translation, but I think what it actually really means, it means the idea of picking things up. That's what it means, yeah? Literally, either literally picking up or mentally picking things up, as in picking up habits or picking up ideas or picking up views or picking up whatever it is. Yeah? So either literally picking things up or in a slightly more metaphorical sense. That is what upadana means. This is what the grass torch is. Yeah? You pick it up. So what happens when you pick things up? What happens when you attach to things in this world? Well, remember, every time you attach for things, you are asking for suffering. Yeah, you're saying, please, may I suffer. Yeah, that's what we're saying, because we know that nature doesn't really allow us to attach to things without it being taken from our grip later on. That's what nature does. This is what anicca, impermanence, is all about. You can grasp as hard as you like. Nature is still going to pull it out from you regardless. Nobody else does it except for nature. And this is kind of the scary thing about impermanence, yeah? Everything is always so unreliable. We don't know. Some of the things we attach to most in this world are our relationships, yeah? But human relationships are so fraught and so uncertain. We just don't know what's going to happen next. At the very least, we know people are going to die. That's the absolute certainty. So if you have a really nice relationship with someone, and sometimes you get into some wonderful relationships, yeah, and then they die, or you die. Then you have to say goodbye. Or the relationship is terrible, it's not really worth it in the first place. Either way, you kind of lose out. Yeah, so the problem with attachment is that you know that it's going to have to end. You know nature is going to come and grip it, rip it out of your hands, and then you're going to suffer as a consequence. So remember that. Every time you attach to something, bang, you're saying, please, may I suffer in the future. And impermanence is so... kind of one nice metaphor for impermanence is the idea of an earthquake. It's like, you know, you're standing on the ground, yeah, you're standing there, and standing is like taking a stand somewhere. It's a bit like attaching, because you are relying on the ground to support you, yeah? And as soon as you rely on something, of course, that reliability isn't actually there. The ground starts to shake, yeah? And before you know it, bang, bang, boop, you fall over, because the ground is shaking too much. And then you hurt as a consequence. You rely on something that was inherently unreliable. And the idea of unreliability is an alternative way of thinking about impermanence. Yeah? Impermanence and unreliability are two sides of the same coin. So this is this idea of holding up, grasping the grass torch. As soon as you grasp something in this life, you take it up, you're attached to it, you're saying suffering always comes next after that. And this is kind of, I think, this is just my interpretation of these similes, yeah? But I think it is not kind of too far off what the Buddha meant. Probably the Buddha had even more meanings with these things. This is one way of looking at these things. Similarly, ground storage. Let's move on to the next one. The next one is really powerful. Okay. Householders, suppose there were a charcoal pit deeper than a man's height, full of glowing coals without flame or smoke. Then a man came who wanted to live and not to die, who wanted pleasure and recoiled from pain. And two strong men seized him by both arms and dragged him towards that charcoal pit. What do you think, householder? Would that man twist his body this way and that? Yes, venerable sir, why is that? Because that man knows that if he falls into that charcoal pit, he will incur death or death-like suffering because of that. So too, householder, a noble disciple considers us. Sensual pleasures have been compared to a charcoal pit by the Blessed One. They provide much suffering and much despair, but the danger in them is great. This is pretty kind of over the top, isn't it? Do you think the Buddha is exaggerating? How can sensual pleasures be compared to a charcoal pit? It doesn't make any sense. Yeah, it's just enjoyable. You have a nice relationship, you have a nice car, yeah. You've got a brand new BMW. Having a BMW be a charcoal pit. Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, beautiful. I was driven with a BMW quite recently back in Perth. Sometimes as a monk you get this kind of really strange things that have nothing to do with monastic life, but somebody said, okay, you're going back with this car. I said, okay, whatever. Get into the car, turns out this brand new BMW, incredibly fancy car. Gee, looked like a spaceship or something. And how can that be a charcoal pit? How is that possible? And this is why these similes are so interesting, because they really get you out of your ordinary way of thinking about things. Yeah, how is that possible? And the way the Buddha explains this, and it is explained in another sutta, and the sutta I haven't included here is called the Magandhya Sutta. It's the 75th sutta of the Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length sayings. And this is where the Buddha explains this particular simile in more detail. And what he says is as follows. Suppose you are a leper. Yeah, you know, like leprosy. Yeah, it's this illness where you have all these sores on your limbs all the time, really bad sores. And sometimes you get maggots to infest those sores because it's so bad. And it's incredibly itchy, apparently. Yeah, not many people have leprosy these days. Apparently, there's still a few in India, etc., but not much left of these terrible illnesses. It's supposed to be incredibly itchy. It's so itchy. And if you have that, you will often go to the charcoal pit. Yeah? And then you will put your hands or your limbs, whatever it is, over that charcoal pit. And the word they use is cauterize your limbs. Cauterize literally means you burn them. That's what it means. And the reason why you do that is because it gives you relief from that terrible itch that is always there. Yeah, when you burn, maybe it damages your hand or whatever, or your nerves, and that's why it gives you relief from the itch. So you burn, you go ahead and burn your hands. And then the Buddha says, now suppose that leper, his family, they come and get him, they take him to a doctor, the doctor cure him of that leprosy, yeah? Then he's very happy after he's been cured. And the Buddha asked this man called Magandhi, asked him, well, would that leper, would he go back to that charcoal pit and burn his hands now after he's cured? And Magandhi said, of course not. Yeah, it's obvious. Yeah. And then the Buddha says, well, yes, it is obvious, but is it only now that that charcoal pit is hot and burning? Or was it hot and burning also before? Yeah, when he had leprosy. And Magandhi says, yeah, good point. So what's going on here? Well, because before his sense faculties were distorted, he wasn't able to see in accordance with reality. That's why the fire was hot and terrible already then. It appeared to him as pleasurable. Yeah, this is exactly the same as the Buddha with sense pleasures. Just like that leper, yeah, is distorted in his perceptions. In the same way, most people, when they enjoy sensual pleasures, in fact, all people, they are distorted in exactly the same way. Your senses are distorted, and that's why sensual pleasures, which actually are painful, seem as if they are pleasurable. And isn't that kind of really radical? It's almost too hard to believe for most people. Yeah, how can this be possible?
Yeah, we're just enjoying ourselves for goodness sake. Can't we please enjoy ourselves in peace? We don't want to hear these kind of similes. It's too much. It's almost like that. So, but of course, one of the things is that if you are a Buddhist and you're interested in Buddhism and these teachings, you kind of take it seriously. If the Buddha said that, there must be some truth to this. Yeah. And one of way of looking at this, which I think is quite useful, the idea of smoking. Yeah, when you smoke, I don't know some of you probably have smoked before. When I was kind of a teenager or early 20s, occasionally I would smoke a little bit, not kind of regularly, but just kind of occasionally, yeah, because you had to do that to be cool. Yeah, that was kind of the thing when you were young. You've got to be cool, you've got to be kind of, this is kind of how things are at that age. So I would smoke a little bit, and I remember how terrible it was. Yeah, you kind of cough, you try not to cough because then you don't look so cool anymore. but you do these things because it's kind of part of the party scene and that kind of stuff. You know, I didn't go to enormous amounts of parties, but occasionally you had to go to parties and that kind of stuff. And so then you smoke, but actually it was really terrible. It was actually very painful. But the funny thing is that once you are addicted to that, and my brother, he became a smoker actually. And once you are addicted to the nicotine, it actually becomes so nice. You can't wait to get that, when the craving arises, you can't wait to get your hands on a cigarette because it's just so, so nice, yeah, cigarette. But is the cigarette actually nice? The cigarette tastes exactly the same thing it did before. It still is kind of terrible in so many ways. The reason why it is nice, because it stills the craving. That is the only reason why it is so nice, yeah? Because the craving gets stilled. But it feels to you like a very powerful pleasure when you have that cigarette. Because I know people who have been in that situation. And I think it's the same thing with so much of sensuality. One of the interesting things that Ajahn Brahm pointed out to me a while ago was an experiment that had been done. If we go to something like sexual pleasure, for example, and this was an experiment that was done with people while they were having the sexual pleasures, they were putting into an MRI scanner, and the brain was measured while they were in the middle of this. And what was so interesting about this was that the part of the brain that was lighting up while they were supposed to be having pleasure was the pain center of the brain. Isn't that kind of fascinating? The Buddha says in the suttas that it's like a charcoal paint. Then you put them in the MRI scanner and the pain center lights up. You think, this can't be a coincidence. There must be some connection here. And I think it is a bit like smoking cigarettes. Yeah? With some of the essential pleasures, the craving gets so strong and so powerful that a large part of that happiness, a large part of the pleasure from these things actually comes from the relief from the desire, the relief from the craving. That is a large part of it. Yeah, once you see that, it becomes a bit off-putting, doesn't it? It becomes actually not all that interesting at all. What am I doing this for? It's kind of crazy. I go around craving, then I satisfy the craving, and then I crave more so that I can satisfy the craving. We actually seek out craving so that we can satisfy it. Of course, that is endless. There's no end point to that. If you actually seek craving to satisfy it, it will go on forever. There's no end point to that. And that's why it is so ultimately so unsatisfying, and ultimately why it is painful, and ultimately why it is completely pointless and purposeless. So this is, I think, why the Buddha can say these things, why it is like a charcoal pit, because actually it's all about craving. And if you feel craving for what it is, instead of always looking at the goal of the craving, craving itself is very unpleasant. Yeah, if you want that cigarette, but you can't have it, all you have is the craving, it's terrible. It's only because you can get the cigarette that it feels kind of pleasurable or whatever. If you can't get the cigarette, it's terrible. So the craving itself is just a feeling of restlessness, of agitation, of being dissatisfied, of being, of being removed from what you actually want. Craving is always, the amount of craving you have is like the distance between where you want to be and where you are now. And that, of course, is always problematic and always difficult. So that is the simile of the charcoal pit. So next time you see nice BMW, remember, charcoal pit. I don't know if you even like it. Maybe you don't like BMWs, which is perfectly okay, but I'm just kind of using it as an example. Anyway, let's go beyond BMWs and on to the next simile here. householder, suppose a man dreamt about lovely parks, lovely groves, lovely meadows, and lovely lakes, and on waking he saw nothing of it. So too, householder, a noble disciple considers us. Sensual pleasures have been compared to a dream by the Blessed One. They provide much suffering and much despair, while the danger in them is great. Yeah, this is a simile which is quite easy to understand, I think, in many ways. How sensual pleasures are like a dream. It's always something you're trying to get, always something that you have an idea about, oh, it would be so nice if I get that relationship, then I'd be really happy. Yeah, that's the dream. The reality, of course, is quite different very often. Yeah, it never really matches the dream, let's face it. But when I get that, you know, not BMW, I should be talking about English cars. When I get that nice Bentley, yeah? When I get that nice Bentley, whoa, I'll be so happy when I get that nice Bentley here. So, of course, the reality is that it's not actually like that. The reality is often it's often completely different. The dream is one thing. The having it is actually something completely different. The dream is always better. It always seems better than the reality when you get there. And this is the problem. And I also remember, not only is that true in individual cases like that, but it's also true in life overall. Yeah, when you are young, you have a dream about your life. Yeah, I used to dream about my life. I thought, yeah, I'm going to have a relationship like this, a job like that. Yeah, that was a waste of time. Yeah, that was a complete waste of time. this idea how everything is going to kind of turn out. And of course, it never turns out that way. And especially when you're young, you are a bit arrogant. Yeah, the younger you are, it's very common to be a bit arrogant. Right? Yeah, you think you've got the world under control. You kind of get sort everything out, and you get everything kind of the way you want things to be. Yeah, I don't know. I was a bit arrogant when I was young. I hope I'm not so arrogant anymore, but I was when I was young. And I think many people are. And then you kind of start downgrading your dreams a little bit. You realize, yeah, okay, can't quite get that. I kind of realize that. And you keep on downgrading things pretty much throughout your life, yeah? And kind of get more and more realistic as you get older. And this is life, yeah? It's always, the dream is one thing, the reality is often very different. And we keep on dreaming until we die. We're still dreaming when we die because you never really see death coming. And because you don't see death coming, there's always something more you want to do. Always something else that's on the horizon, yeah? Another meditation retreat, perhaps. Yeah? At the very least, yeah? And there's always this future thing, this dream, and it never really materializes. And then you die, and then you continue dreaming in the next life, and it goes on like that. So notice that distinct difference between reality and the dream. A lot of the time we live in our dreams, and the reality does never really matches the dream. Another interesting little sutta. I'm going to jump now over these two next similarly, just leave those aside for a while, and I'm going to go on to the next sutta, which is down called the Samvitti Sutta from the Samyutta Nikaya, because it fits in fairly well with some of these similes. This might be the right point to have a look at it. And this sutta goes as follows. Thus have I heard, on one occasion, the Blessed One was dwelling at Rajagaha in the Hot Springs Park. Then the Venerable Samvitti, having risen at first flush of dawn, went to the hot spring to bathe. Having bathed in the hot springs, he came back out and stood in one robe drying his limbs. So this is like the background story. And I just one little interesting point before I move on to the kind of main aspect of the sutta is this hot springs park. Tapodarama, I think it's called in Pali. And the hot springs park is a place where, you know, these people would go and bathe. The king would go there to bathe as well in those days. The kings of ancient India were very ordinary because they were very small societies. So the kings wouldn't be anything grand about them. So the king Bibisara of Rajagaha, he would go to the hot springs park to bathe as well. It's kind of nice, isn't it? The kings and then the monks, and on one occasion the monks were bathing too long, the king wasn't too happy. These are the kind of stories read in the Vinaya. And if you go to India in the present day, you go to Rajgir, which is the present day version of ancient Rajagaha, you go to Rajgir, yeah, you go to the same place at the foot of the same hill. Actually, the hill isn't mentioned here, but nevertheless, the same hot spring is still there. it's like stepping back in time almost. It's so weird when you get there, yeah? And you go to exactly the same place as in the Sutras, it's exactly the same hot spring, 2,500 years later. Yeah? And you go there and you have all these local people bathing there. Yeah, just as if you're going back. It's a bit more built up now. They have kind of, you know, it's a bit more like a proper bathing place. Yeah, they have some tiles and that kind of stuff. But lots of people bathing there. Yeah? Nothing has really changed. This is kind of the nice thing about going to India, at least once in one's lifetime, to see these places, and this feeling that you're stepping into the sutras. It makes the sutras come alive. You realize these sutras actually have real roots and real historical and geographical places, historical events and geographical places that is actually referred back to. It becomes so obvious when you do these things. That's kind of one of the exciting things about going to India. The more you know about the sutras, the more you know Pali, because if you know Pali, you can almost read some of the signs as you travel around, because some of the Indian languages haven't changed that much since the time of the Buddha. They've changed a little bit, but there's lots of similarities still. So you can read the signs, yeah, and you can see, oh yeah, that kind of fits with, you know, the sutras or whatever. This actually is very nice in its own right. But that is a side track. So let's kind of get back to the main sutra again. So here we have Monk Samidhi. He just been having a bath, just come out of his bath, and then when he had just come out of his bath, then this deity, this devata of stunning beauty, illuminating the entire hot springs, approached the Venerable Samidhi. Having approached, he stood in the air and addressed the Venerable Samidhi in verse. Without having enjoyed, you seek alms, Bhikkhu. You don't seek alms after you've enjoyed. First enjoy, Bhikkhu, then seek alms. Don't let the time pass you by. I do not know what the time might be. The time is hidden and cannot be seen. Hence, without enjoying, I seek alms. Don't let the time pass me by. So, it's a little bit cryptic what he is saying here. Yeah, I don't know what the time might be, but the point is that the devata is saying, enjoy yourself, for goodness sake. You're wasting the opportunity. That's basically what it's about. Then that devata alighted on the earth and said to the Venerable Samidhi, you have gone forth while young, Bhikkhu, a lad with black hair, endowed with the blessing of youth, in the prime of life, without having dallied with sensual pleasures. Enjoy human sensual pleasures, Bhikkhu. Do not abandon what is directly visible in order to pursue what takes time. And he replies, I have not abandoned what is directly visible, friend, in order to pursue what takes time. I have abandoned what takes time in order to pursue what is directly visible. For the Blessed One, friend, has stated that sensual pleasures are time-consuming, full of suffering, full of despair, and the danger in them is still greater. While the Dhamma is directly visible, immediate, inviting one to come and see, applicable or onward leading, to be personally experienced by the wise. So who is right? Yeah, the devata says, well, sensual pleasures are here. Yeah, you can't just go out, enjoy yourself, you know, get married, or, you know, enjoy all the nice food in the village. You can eat in the afternoon. No, you can't even eat in the afternoon. Yeah, it's a wasted opportunity. There's nice entertainment going on there. Yeah, life is so full of marvelous things, and it can be enjoyed right now. What you are seeking for is Nibbana. I think, who knows if there even is a Nibbana? Yeah, you can all agree with that. Who knows if there's a Nibbana? It's kind of absurd. It says so in the suttas. We don't actually, most people don't know that. Yeah, and these jhanas you're trying to get, are they really real? Do they actually exist? And even if they do exist, when are you going to get them? Yeah, it's so uncertain. The enjoyment is right here. What are you waiting for? And then he replies that actually it's the other way around. Who is right? And I once asked this, I went to, because I travel a lot as a Buddhist monk, I travel around everywhere, get the same suttas everywhere, yeah, it's really cheating because same thing again and again and again, but actually I love to do that. Anyway, I went to Indonesia, this was a few years ago, I went to this very charming little town called Balikpapan on Borneo Island. And usually when you go around like this, I only stay for one talk in every city, so usually it's quite large crowds coming. Few hundred people perhaps. So there was a young man sitting on the front bench, yeah. And I asked the ask the crowd, or actually ask, you know, ask the crowd, well, what do you think? Who is right, the Devata or the Manke? And this young man said, yeah, yeah, the Devata is right, the Devata is right. Yeah. Go out, enjoy yourself. And so it seems, right? And so it seems. These things are available straight away. So there's kind of a conundrum here. There is a bit of a, like a koan, if you like, to how to understand this in the right way. But of course, the Devata is not right. It's the monk who is right. Why is that? And of course, the reason is because when you look for sensual pleasures in the world, sensual pleasures are always about the future. Because it is about craving, because it is about seeking something else, it is never in the present moment. By definition, it is in the future when it involves craving. And that is what sensual pleasures are like. There's maybe a moment of satisfaction sometimes, and then the craving restarts again. And even when you get satisfied, you have your meal or whatever, nice meal, you feel kind of a bit dull afterwards, you want to go to sleep or something. It's not that satisfying after all, but the craving is stopped for a short while, and then the craving comes back again. It's always about the future. But the Dhamma, if you practice the Dhamma in the right way, if in the present moment you do an act of kindness, if right here and right now you think an act of friendliness to somebody, you do whatever, even if just inside your own mind you do that, straight away there is a degree of satisfaction there. All you have to do is a tiny thing, turn your mind in the right direction, think about things in the right way, get the Dhamma right in the here and now, even if you don't get the jhana, even if you don't get Nibbana straight away, but down the line, little things happen in the present moment, and you can feel that benefit right here, right now. You do a small act of kindness to somebody, you feel good about it, and that is feeling, experiencing the Dhamma in the present moment. That is what it means. So this is beautiful, it's counterintuitive, it looks like the sensual pleasures are what is easily available, but actually it's a misunderstanding of reality. And once you get it right, it opens up a different way of viewing these things. And actually it's the Dhamma that is available here and now. Anyway, and then at the very end there you have this beautiful little line about the Dhamma being directly visible, immediate, inviting one to come and see, and that is what that really refers to, the idea that it actually can be experienced in the present moment, also in this life, but also in the present moment itself. But I'm not going to go into that. That is the standard epithets or the standard description of the Dhamma in the suttas, akaliko, sambittiko, and that kind of thing. And it's very nice in its own right, but I want to finish the last two similes of the previous sutta, so I'm going to go back to that now. So, let's go to the next simile here. Householder, suppose a man borrowed goods on loan, a fancy carriage and fine jewel earrings, and preceded and surrounded by those borrowed goods, he went to the marketplace. Then people seeing him would say, sirs, that is a rich man. That is how the rich enjoy their wealth. Then the owners, whenever they saw him, would take back their things. What do you think, householder? Would that be enough for that man to become dejected? Yes, venerable sir, why is that? Because the owners took back their things. So too, householder, a noble disciple considers thus. Sensual pleasures have been compared to borrowed goods by the blessed one. They provide much suffering and much despair, while the danger in them is great. If you borrow these goods, and if you're not careful, after a while you start to identify with these things. You travel around in a nice carriage, and surrounded by all kinds of fancy goods. People look at you and they kind of look, wow, you're really wealthy or whatever. And of course, you start to identify with that, and you start to feel like you are that person. And then the people who have lent those things to you, they take it back again, and then you feel kind of naked, because you're identified with those things. It's almost as if your identity or your personality is kind of being challenged in that particular situation. This is what life is like. Life is precisely like that. Life is a... And we spend usually most of our life pursuing the sensual objects of the world. There's many ways we do that, but of course we build up a certain amount of possessions, we build up a relationship, we build up an identity around so many things, our social position, our education, our positioning, our family, and all of these kind of things. Our identity is all based around these things. So all of these things in the world that we build up for ourselves, and yet all of these things in our life, they are like borrowed goods. We think that we own them, but the reality is that if we really own something, if it really is yours, you could control them. And you can't control these things in your life. Your relationships break up. The things that you own so proudly, they disappear, they get stolen, they get burnt down if you live in Australia. Or at the very least, when you die, you're going to have to give it all up. So the problem with life is that we spend our whole life investing our time, investing our scarce resources in building up things that we're going to have to give up. Yeah, it's all going to have to go. It's all nothing of this you can hold on to. And very often it goes a long time before you die. Relationships are notoriously unreliable. You don't know what's going to happen next. So if you spend your whole life building up things that you're going to have to give up when you die, and that's all you do. And in the process, because these things are so important to you, this is what life is about, this is the purpose and aim of life, because they are the purpose. You do immoral things on the way, you do bad things on the way as well. Then you come to the end of your life. Everything you have done in your life has been for the purpose of things that you have to give up. What does it make you feel like when you die? It makes you feel like you have wasted your time. It makes you feel you have invested in things you can't take with you. It makes you feel as if life is pointless and meaningless. You die confused, you die and you don't really understand. What was the point of all this? It's crazy. Yeah, now I have to give it all up. This is what happens. And the reason we don't get it is because we always think death is somewhere down the track. It's not going to happen right now. And then we forget to invest in the long term. Well, this is why this idea of rebirth actually matters so enormously in Buddhism. You can't just chuck out rebirth and think that everything is going to be exactly the same regardless. Especially when the Buddha says this is a part of right view, it is part of the very foundation of what Buddhism is about, the first factor of the Noble Eightfold Path. The reduction of delusion, independent origination, is to understand ideas about rebirth, and all of this. Because when you have an idea of rebirth, you look at life in a very different way. Instead of having this narrow slice of time, you're born here, you die over here, this narrow slice of time is all you see, suddenly it opens up to this enormous thing, the potential for almost endless lives in the future, and certainly going back in the past. And that changes your investment strategy. Have you got an investment strategy? This is the kind of investment that really matters. All other investment strategies are kind of, who cares? But this one really matters. It makes a massive difference. Because you understand that it is crazy just to focus on this life. If there's so many lives coming down the line, why have such short-term investments? You should invest for the long-term. What is that long-term investment? It is investing in your mind. It is investing in your heart. It's investing in those things that you can take with you after you die. What are those things? Your personal qualities. That is what you take with you after you pass away. It is so obvious when you think about it. Yeah, everybody can get this. You have to have an idea of rebirth, first of all. But once you have an idea of rebirth, it is so obvious. So how do we do that? How do we change the investment? Does it mean that everyone here should become monks and nuns straight away? Is that what it means? Not necessarily, right? It doesn't actually mean that, because we have all different positions in life, we have all different responsibilities. It doesn't really mean that. What it means is that how we live our life changes. We no longer focus so much on the worldly goals, we focus much more on the process that leads to those goals, on the how rather than the what of life. So if you have a job, for example, instead of always striving to kind of get to a certain goal in your job and to get the advancements and get a higher salary, instead of always thinking about that house, that nice house you want to buy for yourself or whatever it is, or thinking about that relationship you want to get into, you think about the process that gets you to those goals. If you want to, if you're in a company or you want to have success in your professional life, you don't worry too much about that goal. Or rather, you allow those goals to happen if they happen. But what you are concerned about is the process, how to get to that goal. And instead of that process involving immorality, instead of it involving backstabbing and saying bad things about your colleagues, the process now becomes a process of kindness. You look after your colleagues, you bring them a cup of tea, yeah. Or a cup of coffee, is that what they prefer? Or you say something nice to your colleagues, wow, what a wonderful thing, how lucky I am to have you as a colleague. How often does that happen? How often do your colleagues come to you and say, wow, it's such a wonderful thing to have you as a colleague? How many people raise their hand when you ask that question? Nobody, because it doesn't happen. If you can say that to your colleague, what a wonderful thing it is to have you as a colleague, you have done something that almost nobody does. Yeah, congratulations for you. So I'm going to say it now. What a wonderful thing it is to have you as a colleague. Yeah? It's a really great thing. Yeah? Now I'm giving by example. Yeah, it actually is. I'm not saying that as just because to make a point, well, a little bit, of course, but not entirely just because of that, because it's true. I really do appreciate my colleagues in the monastic life. So remember that, yeah? And then you change the process, the how you do things. The process is what matters. It's in the process that you either make good karma or bad karma. It's in the process that you are moral or immoral. You are generous or stingy, yeah? That is what matters. And then if the goal happens, great. If the goal doesn't happen, you have lived the process right. Just a little bit of good about yourself. It's a win-win situation. If you get the goal through immorality, through taking shortcuts, through doing bad things on the way, yeah, even if you get the goal, you're still going to feel bad about yourself at the end of the day. So what's the point? I've gone over time. This is really bad. I'm just going to finish this little thing anyway. Our monks in our monastery is actually just an Anagarik. He just recently came over from the United States to become an Anagarik. Very nice young man. And he told me that when he was he had just come over, just had a dinner before he came over to Australia with a kind of a colleague of his. It wasn't really a colleague, but an acquaintance or whatever. And this colleague told him that he had been very successful. He had made a large amount of money, probably didn't need to work for the rest of his life. So my friend said, well, why don't you just chill then? Why don't you just relax and enjoy the money? I can't, he said. I need to work all the time. Then he told him that to get that money, he had taken so many shortcuts. He had cheated so many people in the process that he felt terrible about himself. I feel really like a nasty character. He had destroyed his life, yeah? Thinking that he was building up his life, making money. Actual fact, he had destroyed his own life through his badness, through his bad behavior and living things in the wrong way. Well, he hasn't really destroyed it fully because he can always get back on the path again by starting to live well. But so far, he had lived a life that was so self-destructive. Yeah, it is so obvious. It is not about the goals. The goals are actually irrelevant. The process is what matters in life. Live the process right, and then you're going to have a fulfilling life, whether the goals happen or not. This is what this is about. Yeah, this is what, remember, all of these things in the world, they are borrowed goods. You have to give them up. If you want to have a meaningful life, you have to invest somewhere else. Invest in the process. Invest in the way you live. If you want to be a monastic, wonderful. I think it's great when people become monastics, but you don't have to. You can live well as a lay person as well. But I have been getting a little bit too excited during this talk, so I have a kind of the last simile. I'm going to have to leave it till later. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to say stop there. But we'll see you back again this evening at 7 o'clock.